peace, man. Roby. Peace, Ryan. Thumbs up if you hear me. Thanks, Roby. I appreciate it, man. My brother across the pond. What up, Ryan? Peace, Jamal. Oh, thank you for the thumbs up. Okay, we good on the sound. LJ, what up? Peace. Craig, welcome back. Thomas the Great, what up? My brother C Popular, what up? Peace, Anna. You already know Thomas, citizens in the background for show. Gotta represent, you know what I'm saying? That flag. My brother C, peace, man. Yeah, y'all hear that music in the background, you know. You wanna know who's producing all that? That's gonna be our guest today, Mr. Ice Rocks DXA. Well, he's got some gems, man. So I hope y'all enjoyed today's episode. Peace, DC7. Yeah, he said he's going to tap in probably about 6:01, 6:02. I hope everybody's doing well. All is well, DC7, man. Thank you, Shireen. I'm just thankful to man to keep, I'm 12 episodes in, I'm just thankful for that. That's something I really wasn't planning on doing, but so far so good, man. Just thankful, man. Nikki, Miami, what up? Aaron, what's up, Aaron? D. Sharif, what up? No meeting, Shireen. I'm sorry. But I appreciate the comments. The official peace family. Ice Rocks, what up? You in here? You ready, bro? Yeah, I had to get Ice, man. Ice, that's my bro, man. We really had to get it in today. You ever ready to join, Ice, man? We can go ahead and get it in, bro. It's been long overdue. The official on the wheels of steel. Y'all say what up to the official, man. That's Rock Marciano's official DJ. And Blood Cousin, of course. Ice Rocks.
Good, man.
My brother, how are you?
Chilling, man.
Yeah?
Studio.
Yo, man, please, man. How y'all, man? It's been long overdue. What was the last time we seen each other? Did you come to the Westside Gun Rock joint at Sony Hall?
Yes, yes.
Okay, that was the last time. Okay, 2019.
That was a while.
Yeah, that was, man. That's definitely a while ago.
Yeah, because me and May, we haven't running a while. We haven't been down to D.C. and whatnot. And
right.
I was going to come down for the march, but I wasn't able to make it down. I'm not able to make it down. And fortunately, you know, I was able to do this over IG and whatnot.
Yeah, man. It's definitely long overdue, bro. I had to get my man on the live today because, you know, your production has definitely been influential in my listening. So I definitely wanted to get you on here. You know what I'm saying?
Appreciate that. I appreciate that.
All right. Let me go ahead and welcome you to the set, man. Episode 12. Everybody, if you can, say hello to my brother, Ice Rocks DXA, producer extraordinaire. He's joining us on Choppin It Up with the Conduit today. You can go ahead and say peace to everybody, Ice.
Thank you for having me. I'm happy to be here, you know?
Peace to everybody joining in. I apologize if I don't hit the wave button, but I do see y'all coming in, man. Ice, man. So, yeah, straight out of Queens, NYC, right?
Yes, sir. I mean, I grew up in Manhattan in the Lower East Side, East Village area. But I've been in Queens for, like, 16 years now or something. So,
yeah.
Plus, I mean, Queens hip-hop has always been a huge influence in my life. So I feel like it's only right that that's moved and stayed for a long time. Honestly, in my opinion, some of the best hip-hop in the legacy. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I agree.
As far as, like, artists and different kinds of artists coming from the same place.
Yes.
Work a lot of amazing music that shaped sound. I mean, other places also, but
yeah.
Galaxy always had a wide range of.
Yeah, that's definitely a different feel with Queens. Queens is definitely one of my favorite boroughs as far as MCs come out, but I know I also have a good affiliation with Long Island as well. So it just seems like the two have they something in the water.
Yep. True. Right.
I
was talking to Dallas Penn a while ago, and he was like, he said the same thing. He said something about in the water. He's like, think about it. Like, in such a small place, so many amazing artists, not even just Queens, like, you go to other boroughs, like, and you listen to the vast range of sound styles and, you know, male, female, whatever, like, yes. It spans the whole range. And then
definitely right.
So there's tons of jazz musicians from St. Albans and different sound, and you know, it's a big legacy.
Okay, you're definitely right. And I noticed with, you know, your music and your production, I noticed that it has that Galaxy of Queens feel, like the airy horns, you know what I'm saying, the hard drums, the hard kicks, you know what I'm saying? The snare, so on and so forth. So I just wanted to build on that. You know what I'm saying? Of course, you see right here.
Appreciate it.
You know what I'm saying? You take it back nostalgic with the cassettes and the vinyl. You know what I'm saying? I definitely had the support.
Bring you. I have one of the vinyl for you. I got you.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate it.
Of course.
Thank you. All right, well, I mean, let's get it in. You know what I'm saying? You know, the Galaxy of Queens, you said, for about 16 years. And in your production, I have a feeling I know maybe Lars Professor and RZA are a heavy influence in your production.
There's a lot, but I think 36 years changed my life as far as, like, the way I listen to and the style. It was just so different. And then, like, Wu-Tang, other thing. So the RZA, definitely huge influence. Professor, Lord Finesse, you know, who I'm homies with now. You know, just like a lot of those guys that, you know, search for certain sounds and even those snares that made you blink. You those records without blinking when the snares hit.
Yeah.
Sharp. And there's there's a lot of different people that influenced. Prince Paul was a huge influence in me. He's a highly slept on.
Underrated
heavily. Like, you want to, if you do, like, you know, do the knowledge on it, you listen to him and he's doing production, like, De La Soul stuff and Grave Diggers, like, in the same year.
Yes.
And people are like, don't realize that. And then you go back and you listen, you know, Stetsasonic and all these guys. And he was an influence, you know, a part of that. and you listen to, I mean, one of my favorite albums is Prince Among Thieves.
Mm.
The way he tells the story, and it like has so many different artists.
Yes.
It's cohesive, and yeah, that's like an incredible album.
So yeah, Prince Paul is definitely a mastermind.
Oh, 100%.
100%. Yeah. I think with Prince Paul, he slept on just as I think his Large Professor has slept on as well. Like,
yeah,
I look at Large as, you know, a genius as well. And people forget, you know, he helped bring, you know, one of the top five MCs along, you know what I'm saying? But yet when people talk producers, you know, he really doesn't get, you know, the recognition that he should.
Oh yeah, no, 100%. He's a good dude too, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
brought him through the studio years ago and I met him, and he's like, every time I see him, he shows love, says what up, you know? You know, he's a humble guy. You know what I mean? He's a humble guy. Made some incredible with, you know, a lot of broke artists. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you're definitely right about that, man. Well, I wanted to get into DXA.
Okay.
Dome Piece, D-Face, Triple C, and yourself. Now, okay. a lot of people on here don't know. Yeah, you spit bars too.
A lot more. I don't know. For me, it started, you know, like me and the homies would get together. We'd drink a 40, smoke something, get, you know, and, you know, like that cipher was kind of what got me started. And I would always be going to these record stores and picking up 12 inch singles, and, you know, that had instrumentals so we could dial and whatever. And I started them and they were urging me to do it. But then I kind of was like, I started beats and, you know, I started getting better at that. And I felt like they were already rapping before me. So you know what? If I'm better at this, I might as well. Right. Yeah. So still do it here and there. Like, not so much as much anymore because I've really focused on the production, but it's fun. I always like doing it. You know what I mean? Like, but I never really as serious. But yeah, I mean, you can, if you look out there, some verses of mine out in the wild.
Yeah, I had to let the people know, you know, because of course I introduced you as, you know, producer extraordinaire, you know what I mean? And I had to let them know that you do have some bars out here. You know, you're very multifaceted. You're versatile with it.
Thank you, man. I appreciate that. It's, you know, I feel like it was always something that I had to kind of dabble in, you know what I mean? Even just for the love of it, you know, but even like listening to old hip hop when I was like first getting into it, I always listened to the beat first.
Yeah.
Like it's all about the rhymes. It's all about the, you know, the rhymes or the bars or whatever. But for me, it was always about that what caught me. So if you had a dope beat, okay, I'll take a listen. Good. I mean, for me, I'm not going to say that they were a bad, good. Good point to bring up for that is group.
Right. They
were peppers, but that album is fire. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, it's considered classic.
Right, exactly. So, like, to me, it was always about the beats. Always.
So that's the producer side in you then.
Yeah, that's where it's, you know, that's the reason why I figured, okay, if I was always listening for samples and for things and trying to find what people use, like, I guess I had the ear for that, right? And then I went to audio engineer school for like a little while. I never really finished because it wasn't really my thing. But we had an assignment where they were like, okay, pick this song, and I'm going to come back and listen for like, you know, an hour and a half or whatever.
Right. So
the teacher comes back, and he's like, oh, you're done quick. I was like, yeah, you know, take a listen. So I listened to it. He's like, this is really good. He goes, but where are the vocals? Realized that they were still muted on the board because I wasn't even paying attention to it.
Right.
Music sounds good now. I got it mixed, you know, but I completely forgot about the vocals. I was like, oh wow, like I didn't think about that. He's like, oh, you got some more work to do, and then I'm like, okay, now I got to focus on this and, you know, train my ear a little bit to pay attention to that too.
What are some of your machines that you like working with? What was your first one that, you know, that you fell in love with, where you started, you know, making your beats?
The first machine I started using was 1000X MPC. So, my homie had, like, you know, he was the first person had to use it and, like, make beats. And my man Brian, and he's like, yo, you can hold on to it. It was fun, but I'm not really into it like how you are, you know?
Yeah. So
I had it for a bunch of, was making some beats, doing it. And then he was like, yo, someone offered me money for it, so I'm good. He's like, do you want it? And but what they offered him more money than I was going to pay for it. So he was like, yo, sell it, whatever. And then I found an MPC 2000, and I just bought that. And I actually happen to like the 2000 better because the jog wheel is different, and I right. like the way it did. So I started using that, and that's what I kind of took off with. And then I was like, okay, I want a crunchier sound. I want something that's, you know, a little bit more like the people I was listening to, rocks, the whatever. So I bought an SP in 2006 for like $9, and which those things now are going for like $5,000 or something.
Yeah.
I got one sitting for $900.
A lot of classic albums were made on that machine.
God, the list goes on and on and on. It just has this sound, you know what I mean? Like, you can't replicate it. I mean, they've and there's stuff that's close that makes it not the same. It's not. It's just you can't really capture that.
Mm.
But it's a great machine. It's you know, it's a little work on as far as, because you have to, you know, it's a 10-second sample time.
Right.
So 2.5 seconds per head. So you got to, like, you know, record like a little snippet, chop it down, erase it, You had to, like, build it up. And if you wanted to, you had to, like, there was another way. You save the drums that you chopped up onto a disc.
Mm.
And erase everything, sample the music in, be able to do a little bit more. And then you have to upload the drums again to try to save some time. You would record the record at 45 and slow it down on the machine. Things you could do to get that little extra timing or whatever. And that was that's kind of what helped me be, like, listen differently. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I had to listen in pieces. And then I'm like, okay, well, I got to rearrange this. So some beats, like, even if I loop stuff up, I would have to take the pieces and then re-put it together and then, you know what I mean? And then I got an S950, which is a rack sample. I went with the SP really well. Using those to, you know, I like MIDI one to the other. And that's kind of how I built my style, my sound, and just listening to a lot of old into, you know?
Yeah, so let me ask the people a question. Give me a thumbs up, y'all, if y'all good with the audio. Because I don't want them to miss your words either as well.
Can you hear me all right?
Yeah, I can hear you good. I just don't want you to make sure you're not breaking up on anything.
Got you.
All right, yeah, we got a couple thumbs up, so we good. Yeah, thank you, Aaron. All right, that's what's up. So now, I want to talk about the era that I got hip to your music. Like, of course, I got hip roughly around 2011, 2012, you know, through AG.
Uh-huh.
And a lot of people don't, you know, that are joining in, I want them to know that you are part of that underground legacy that was coming through the ranks that a lot of people are listening to now, from, you know, Action Bronson to, you know, Meyhem Lauren, you know, Rock Marciano, you know, of course, with Muggs, what he's doing now with a lot of these young MCs, so on and so forth. It just seems like Queens and Long Island just has this affinity for each other within the music, and it seems like they mesh so well. So, you know, I wanted to get that part in. So, with that being said, how did you end up linking with, you know, Meyhem Lauren? How did the two of you link?
Okay, so basically, me and my homie D-Fit from DXA had a radio show at Baruch College, because he went to Baruch College, and basically it was called the Dirty Hour, you know, space, so it'd be the 30 hour. So we basically play, we'd play all just throwback hip hop stuff that we loved, and then we started incorporating newer stuff liking. And for I think for 2.5 years, or maybe even 3 years, same song twice. And every we had to clean all the music.
Right.
So we had to sit there and reverse curses on, you know, a show every single week for like for 3 years. So we started archiving music, and then basically we met Solis from Timeless Truth, who went to school there also.
Okay.
Yo, you gotta get my man. So he's nasty. I'm telling you, you guys will get along. You guys will like his stuff. He is like, you know, starting to come up in the world. And I was like, all right, yo, I'm down. Like, let's, we're down. Let's do it. So D-Face arranged it, and we had him come by. And it was, I think it was really him and Thurston together.
Right.
Make it for some reason. So Mayhem came dolo. We had a great show. We had a good time. We were hanging out. And then at the end, we were like, yo, can you do a little, you know, a little freestyle or drop or whatever for the show? He's like, of course. So he gets in the booth, and I pull up a beat, and he does a verse for it. And he comes out the booth, like, yo, what is that? What beat is that? He's like, word? He's like, I need it. And I was like, well, we're kind of using it for DXA, but got other shit come through. So he's like, where's your studio? I said, in Queens. He's like, all right, I'm coming. He's like, I'm Queens all day. So he came to the studio, and I played him one beat, and it was Got the Fever.
Wow.
That was the first beat I had played him like in the studio, and it became Got the Fever. And then, you know, a little bit down the road, we did Raw Cashmere.
Yes, Raw Cashmere.
One of the song, I think it was one of the songs, one of the beats that was on Raw Cashmere was the beat that I originally played him in at Brew College, because we ended up not using it, so it ended up going on Raw Cashmere.
So, Got the Fever.
Yeah, no. The other beat here that I told him he couldn't have.
Oh, okay.
I think it was like Spice Channel, like one of those songs. I think it was that song. But that's, you know, that's kind of how we built it. And then we did more Cashmere, so on and so forth. And now we're working on some more stuff. So we're getting back.
Yeah, I know. I've been talking with Mayhem lately, and he was actually going to be a guest this past August, because I know he has some work coming along with, you know, our brother Derringer. Yes. But he was just like, yo, I want to fall back. I want to make sure I do it at the right time. So, of course, Mayhem will be in here in September. He's not going to be on an actual, like, Sunday. Just giving Mayhem whatever date he wants. You feel what I'm saying? And then we're going to get it in there. You know what I mean?
Make it happen. You'll make it happen.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, I had one person in there say you're going in and out.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, that's what the official said that. Rocks DJ, bro.
Yeah, no, I know the official. He's the homie, man. We were on tour together. Wow.
Yeah, he just said a White Bronco tour.
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah, no, we had fun on that run. He was there for I think it was half of it or so, but we had a good time. We did the whole East Coast run with him, and I didn't make it to the Midwest. I linked back up with them on the West Coast. But yeah, is it getting any better? Does it sound?
Yeah, it's definitely better than what it was, because I know beforehand it was like in and out. Now it's definitely better.
Let me make sure my.
Yeah, D official said yes, sir. Aaron said it's fine for her. Yeah, you good to go. Yeah.
So
we money now.
All right, cool.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, Craig. Thank you, Bigger. And they wanted to hear the words from my brother.
I appreciate that.
I wanted to talk to you about your relationship or former relationship with Chopped Herring.
Okay. Yeah, so basically we were, you know, DXA was released records on like our own and through another label called which ended up folding. They kind of like disappeared. And then basically Mayhem and I, you know, Mayhem had released, I think, the Welcome to the Great Outdoors, one other project through Chopped Herring.
Yeah.
So yeah. I just go with them to do the vinyl run. And at the time, you know, they gave us terms and like the record sold pretty well, and but kind of had a cult following to it at the time. Yeah. And you know, we waited a long time to release it digitally, which you know, at first it wasn't the idea, but it ended up happening that way. I don't know. I was going through a phase where I was like against digital streaming.
Yeah.
You know, so we kind of held off for a while.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, now it's all on streaming. You can check it out on all the sites and whatever. But Chopped Herring was a good relationship, and we got, you know, out some good projects through them, and we had a good, you know, I talked to the guy who runs the website about a month ago, you know,
mm-hmm.
just hit me up on we, you know, we chopped it up. But yeah, it's still all of.
Now I know you got some I think the newest one I checked out was Nomads. For me personally.
Okay.
With XP.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? How did the both of you come together?
So XP and I, we were, so DXA was on tour in Amsterdam. We were doing a show in Amsterdam, a show in Heerlen in the Netherlands, and we did a show in Germany. And when we did the Amsterdam date, there was three acts on the bill. It was us, the group The Shoguns, whose like album release it was, and XP.
Right. Right.
And I had like 101 degree fever, and I'm standing outside the venue, and XP walks up to me. He's like, "Yo, what's going on, man? Like, I mess with your music. I like your stuff. Like, I'm performing tonight." He's like, "I'm from California." I was like, "Oh, dope. And he opened up the show, and I was like, "Okay, this fit."
Yeah.
And we just kind of formed a relationship there. And then when I was going out to Cali to do a run, and we had no show in LA. We had a show in San Diego, Oakland, but there was no show in LA. And within like 3 days, XP had a flyer, us on the show, had everything squared away. And he was like, "We're ready to rock." So I was like, "Okay, my man's like about his business." I was like,
"Yeah."
You know, some people are like, "Oh, I get the show. They never send you the flyer, blah, 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 blah." But he was about it. So, you know, we just kind of became close, and over the years built an album, you know?
Yeah, definitely. I wanted to get into your thoughts on vinyl, because I know how, you know, you're very passionate about that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I noticed with, you know, Live from the Bunker, you know, Bunker Beats 2, of course, you know, Raw Cashmere, More Cashmere, Nomads, you know, you're definitely on the vinyl tip. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of people, you know, for me, I still like to collect beats.
Nice.
You know what I mean? Like, this is a part of, you know, the adolescence of my childhood of growing up in hip hop, where it was cool to actually open up, you know, the cassette, and you get your tape. You know what I'm saying? You still get your inside liner notes and things of that nature. And you actually have to sit through the project. You don't go through the fast forward and the rewinding where it's now it's, oh, as soon as you maybe hear the first 30 seconds, you skip. You know what I'm saying? So I noticed, you know, when it comes with your music, you're always packaging, you know, in that manner, whether it's cassettes or vinyl. Like, what does vinyl mean to you as a producer and you know, also as an artist?
I mean, to me, it's kind of like there's something about holding the record in your hands. There's something about looking through the booklet, looking through the who produced what, who engineered the song, like just like different things of that nature. I don't know. There's always been like a nostalgia factor with that. And also with me, like, you know, becoming a producer and like searching for samples and people have used it, you know, kind of navigating that. Like I always looked at who played the horns on this, who played the guitar, who played the bass, like, and then finding their music, kind of navigating that world. So to me, it was like, it kind of just, that's the way we all, there was always a want to put my music on vinyl, you know? And then the cassette thing, like, the cassette thing, I just love cassettes too, because they were, like, hard to break, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, eventually they pop, you know, you listen to them enough, things happen.
Yeah. But
you could, like, tape them back together, and, like, you know what I mean? Like, if you were nice with it,
yeah,
you know, it could just, you know? And then I just, and then listening to radio shows and just pressing record and recording music and making your own mixtapes, and that's kind of where it all kind of came from. And I don't know, to me, there's something amazing about the physical aspect and, like, collecting things.
Yes.
You know, I collect sneakers, I collect Wallabies, like, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I'm kind of a hoarder, so, you know, that kind of goes hand in hand. You know what I mean?
And that's what's up, man. Dang, you know, I wanted, yeah, I definitely wanted to get you on today. That's why I reached out, you know, a couple months back, you know what I'm saying? Because, yes, we work, you know, amongst, you know, with each other, with our peers, and, you know, we always see each other in, you know, venues, whether it's down here or in, you know, New York, you know what I'm saying, at certain venues. But, you know, we never really get to actually sit down and actually chop it up and talk, you know what I'm saying? Every time we get in there, definitely Photo Rob got to make sure he gets a flick of us, you know what I'm saying? So, yep. You know, that's usually always on the aspect of that.
I think the last time we were able to, like, really chop it up is when we came down to do that tree event.
The pop-up.
Yeah, and me and you were, like, able to sit down for a little while and talk, but that was, like, a few years ago now, like, now that I think about it.
Yeah, you're like, right.
And then every time we're at a show, it's like we're moving around. You're taking care of the event, making sure it gets done, and then, you know, it just, we're not able to build as much, so it's nice to be, like, be on here and do.
Exactly. You know? Our brother Bond said, what's up? Peace, Bonds.
Bonds.
Yeah, you already know the family.
That's my guy.
Yeah, definitely, man. I just definitely wanted to get it in because, you know, I always admired, you know, your music and your production from afar. You know, Meyhem has always definitely been, you know, one of my favorite MCs, just, you know, so far as his delivery and, you know, his personality, you know, all together. You feel what I'm saying?
100%.
So it was only right to make sure that, you know, I get the person who helps craft the music to one of the MCs that I, you know, I call one of my favorites, you know what I mean?
Yeah, he's just one of those people that, like, he's funny, real, he's got that, like, you know what I mean? He's just, he embodies what his music, you know what I mean? He's not like, you know, you meet him and he's very personable and he's very, like, a nice guy.
Very. But
he's, you know, he's also got his other side and, you know, he's about what he talks about. You know what I mean? It's not just like made up fairy tales. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
truly the mayor.
Exactly. No, 100%. When we go out, like, it's funny because everybody says about me, like, when we go out, you always bump into people you know.
Yeah.
For Meyhem, it's like he bumps into people that he has never no idea who they are, but they all know who he is.
Yeah, they definitely. You know what I
mean? So, like, we go anywhere and they're like, hey, what's good? You know, can I get a picture? Like, so then I become like a photographer for fans and stuff, you know. But it's cool. It's fun.
It's all love, man, and that's the best thing about it, man. Well, exactly. I want to know if you got any, you know, future works, you know, any more instrumentals that you might be in the process of doing since we've been in this quarantine.
Yes, I have a lot coming. I have a solo album that's, like, pretty much done. That's going to be, you know, it's right now it's eight tracks with featuring a bunch of different artists. Okay. You know, the usual suspects.
Usual suspects, of course.
You know, for the most part, other people. But it ranges. It's not like it's a few people that I don't think you've heard me work with before, but it makes complete sense that I'm working with them.
Right.
And then some people that, you know, been meaning to do stuff for a long time and hasn't come about, or then other people that, like, my man Matt is on there on a couple songs. Rome Streets, Benny.
Okay, okay.
The list is there.
Yeah, you in the right cipher.
Yeah, yeah.
Awesome.
It's dope, and I'm excited to get that going. And I like just came up with a name. I'm not gonna go say it yet, okay. But I got it. I'm getting the artwork done, and should be coming out in the next, hopefully, the next 2 months or so.
All right. Well, I know with the way this country's going right now, I don't know when shit's been to open back up or right now, but I'll definitely be on the standby looking forward, you know, because, you know, you're always dropping some heat. Why don't you tell the people how they can, you know, get in touch with you, or if there's some aspiring artists that might want to, you know, rap along your beats, go ahead and tell them how to get in touch with you, bro.
On all social, it's just at icerocksdxa, icerocksdxa. Same thing with my email at gmail.com. That's pretty much it. And, I mean, I got that album coming. Me and Manhattan have an album coming with, well, we just dropped like an EP.
Yeah.
Called Kitchen Chronicles. And then we're working on his album, which is, I think I did half of it about.
Okay.
And then I kind of linked him with some other people too, and he reached out and got some beats from other people. And then I got an album with Screwtape coming from the Philly, like South Jersey, Philly area.
Okay. All right.
And then me and Mayhem are working on some more stuff. What else? I got some other things. I don't know.
You working, bro.
There's about 8 projects that are like in the process of being made.
You working, and that's peace.
Yeah, that's yeah. Crazy. I don't want to divulge too much too early, you know, because sometimes things don't pan out. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But all the things that I mentioned are like pretty much done and gonna come in the near future.
All right, that's what it is, man. Well, you already know you got my support, of course. What's that?
No, you got some stuff you're working on. I want to know what you.
Well, I mean, honestly, right now it's really just this podcast right now. I've been thankful that I have a great executive producer in Mika Sunga. If I pronounce her last name correct, I apologize if I didn't. But Mika has been very instrumental in what I've been doing as of late with this IG Live and this Choppin It Up podcast. I'm waiting on logos right now because we're supposed to be up on Spotify and Apple soon. Nice. We're already up on SoundCloud.
Nice.
As you can see, I'm 12 episodes in.
Yes, yes.
You know, and I thank you for, you know, being my 12th episode today. Thank you for joining me. So that's really been, you know, a lot of what I've been working on. Of course, in the cut, you know, waiting on stuff, you know, for Rock Marciano. Of course, we got Mount Marcy coming.
Yes, yes.
Excited
for then, I'm always excited for a new rock.
Yeah, yeah. With rock, man, it's always an adventure with rock, so to speak. You know what I'm saying? I just stay in the cut and wait, and whenever he's ready to rock and roll, you already know we just move forward. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, honestly, my $30 is always sitting there waiting for a rock album. I don't care. The second it comes out, my money's there. I'm sending it. I want the album. I'm not waiting.
Yeah, we thank you very much for that.
I'm not waiting for Spotify. That's, you know.
Yeah,
he deserves that and more.
Yes, thank you, man. Well, I definitely pass that on to the brother because I'm supposed to be reaching out. I think me and a partner of mine, his name is D King out of Baltimore.
Okay,
he's an MC out of West Baltimore. You know what I'm saying? And we're trying to lock down some stuff with hopefully Alchemist and
nice.
Rock. So we'll possibly be traveling out west very soon.
Nice,
but we're gonna. So when we do so, that we do it very carefully with the certain situation going on.
Oh yeah, no, definitely. But yeah, it's nice. It's nice out there. It's nice to take a trip out west. I always enjoy that.
Well, it'll be my first time going to Cali. I have never.
Oh, word? Really?
Yeah, never.
Yeah. Yeah, I used to go like twice a year before, you know, the pandemic thing situation happened. I was out there like about twice a year, you know. I would hang out with XP, I'd hang out with other homies, make my rounds, go record shopping, hit the beach, you know, go to the local stores and
get some. Yeah, of course.
You know?
Well, you know, Twin said that he's going to take care of me when I come out. Rock said he'll take care of me when I come out. So it's just more a matter of me setting the date when it's time to roll.
They definitely will. And if you need me to link you with XP too, 100%. That's my guy.
You know I'm going to hit the line. Matter of fact, you know, once we're off here and I get ready to post this, I'll send my math in the DM so we can go. You know what I'm saying? Yo, peace to UFO Feeb, yo. He just hopped in the building, bro.
Feeb is good people. I didn't see him
on. Yeah.
That's my guy.
Yeah, that's the young guy right there. I fucks with him heavy.
Yes, sir.
All right, man. Well, I'm going to let you go ahead and get back to your lazy Sunday, man. But I thank you for joining me today, bro. You know what I'm saying? Nah,
thank you for having me, man. Of course, of course. And I wish you much success with the podcast. And I hope that I hope you get the numbers go through the roof. You know?
Well, all in due time. I know this is a slow process, a slow build. This is something I honestly didn't want to get into, but I'm just thankful that I got some good people in my corner.
No, of course. And you know, you know a lot of people, you know a lot of good artists. Why not, right?
Right.
And even if people tap in, you know, a little down the road to the old episodes, it's going to help. You know what I mean? You just got to build the foundation first.
True indeed, man. You're always right about that. And with that being said, man, thank you, Ice Rocks, for joining me, man. I'll definitely tap in a little later so we can mix up the math and then we'll be more personal besides the DMs like always.
No, sounds good. I got to come down to D.C. again too, man. It's been a while.
Come soon, man. We got some good. You already know.
I know. You guys took care of us last time we were there. So.
Yeah, that's what we supposed to do.
Appreciate it.
All right, Ike, you have a good one, brother.
All right, man. Take it easy.
Peace, bro. All right, y'all. That's episode 12 in the can. My brother Ice Rocks DXA, producer extraordinaire. He joined me today on Choppin' It Up. Peace, Feeb. What up, yo? But next Sunday, if you're joining me at 6 o'clock, it'll be my brother Ishmael, aka Butterfly of Diggable Planets, who is now Shabazz Palace. He'll be joining me next Sunday. And then end of the month, we'll be finishing it out with Bumpy Knuckles, Mr. Freddie Fox of Gangstar Foundation, the Militia, Industry Shakedown, so on and so forth. But again, I thank y'all for taking, you know, time out with me today on your Sunday. You could have been anywhere else, but the cliche line, you're here with me. Thanks a lot. Ty Ferris, what up, man? Peace to everybody joining in now. The interview will be up on my page as soon as I shut down. And I look forward to seeing y'all next Sunday. Thank you, C. I thank y'all for your support very much. Mika, I hope I didn't chop your last name up, but you already know what it is. I really do appreciate you. You know, you're the best. You know the vibes. To everyone else, you have a great Sunday. Y'all be safe. Stay masked up. Practice social distancing. Check on your senior citizens. Check on your loved ones. Peace.